Hello, firearms friends. Joel Colander here for Rock Island Auction Company. We are back in the preview hall to show you something that's coming up on day two. So if you're watching this when it comes out, it's the morning of or afternoon of day one. We're going to show you something coming up on the next day of auction, as we like to do. Just kind of remind you, there is an auction going on this weekend. And of course, it is, as always, open to the public. And if you can't make it, you can view all the listings online at rockislandauction.com. Now, bear with us for some noise. When we're filming this, we're still making the finishing touches on the preview hall, so bear with us any noise you hear in the background. And as always, these videos are nothing more than me going around and finding something that I think is pretty cool in the preview hall. And today, that item happens to not actually be a firearm. We happen to have a selection of art, some paintings, some airplane paintings, and some things like that that you're around this room that I'm in now. This is Pat's Place. If you haven't seen our video on that, we'll be sure to throw a link right there so you know what Pat's Place is. And it's actually normally filled with the firearms from the John Fox collection in this Trading Post motif. For this sale, it's actually filled with a pretty handsome selection of U.S. military firearms. In keeping with that motif, as you can see, we have some U.S. military propaganda on the walls around me. Now, I am not an official propaganda expert as to determining authenticity or not. I haven't taken these out of any of the frames or fixtures that they're in to like feel the paper and examine the markings and things like that. So if you're interested in these and whether or not they're authentic, please give us a call. We'll be happy to guide you along in that process as best we can. What I'm here to talk about today instead is just the artwork that they are, propaganda posters as a whole, and just looking at some of the fascinating examples that are coming up on day two. Let's start to my right. Pretty vibrant U.S. Marines poster. First to fight, first in France, first for freedom. Enlist with the Soldiers of the Sea. Apply at 19 Congress Avenue, New Haven, Connecticut. New Haven, Connecticut, of course, we all know is pretty good firearms country in the 19th century. But the picture itself, the green color is pretty good. The color on the painting as a whole is pretty good. And we have these doughboys. You know, they're coming fresh off the right off the coast and into the fight. They're ready to, you know, first to fight. They're really emphasizing the bravery of these men, that they're gonna go in and change the tides of war. And indeed they are. We have 1911 pistols. We have some 1903 rifles. We even have, fascinatingly enough, some Lewis guns off to the left. Now those, I'm sure, being American troops, would be the Savage manufactured Lewis guns, chambered in .30-06, as opposed to the BSA manufactured and chambered in .303. But it's all coming right in. We have the U.S. flag. We have the Marine Corps flag. We have them coming to save this ruin of Europe and these displaced peoples, which are reaching out to their heroic American saviors, of course. And even enough up here, a pretty primitive biplane, even I think by Great War standards, that looks a little more Wright, Orville, and Wilbur Wright than it does the Red Baron. But again, I'm not an aviation expert, and what would have existed in 1917. Now, I say in 1917, basically due to the Lewis guns that they had back here, I would have assumed any later 1918, you would have seen them unloading Browning automatic rifles or bar rifles. So overall, a very fascinating picture. It even gives us sort of a time frame with the picture of the rifles, the airplane. If you're an aviation's expert, feel free to chime in the comments below about when that might help date this photo. But overall, very good color. It is in a frame, a nice frame and matted, so I can't see any of the little markings that you would normally have around the side. But overall, very handsome poster, and I wouldn't mind having it in my office or my gun room. Oh boy, that's the girl. The Salvation Army Lassie, keep her on the job. November 11th through 18th, 1918, United War Work Campaign. First of all, as a whole, as a poster, this looks promising. The colors are vibrant. You can see the paper is slightly yellowed. I like seeing these tattered edges over here, as opposed to like nice new ones. It shows that maybe it's been in and out of some frames over the years. It's seen some wear. It sort of lends towards its authenticity, as does this really nice stamp down here in the bottom right corner. That would be for the International Alliance of Bill Posters, and it's a registered stamp in what looks to be a blue or purple ink. You can see some publication info underneath, like outside of the border. So overall, it lends itself well to its authenticity. Again, not an expert, just hopeful. But let's talk about the context of the photo. First of all, it's not finely or realistically painted like you sometimes see. Like, we even have some what look like sketchy type, you know, charcoal pencil marks on the outside. So it's already sort of with an impromptu look. But the Salvation Army lassie, keep her on the job. We might initially think like, oh, it's for the Salvation Army women. We're going to you know, make sure we enlist to keep them employed so they can keep providing us donuts and these comforts of home that the Salvation Army was known for. These Salvation Army lassies really did help soldier morale during the First World War and turned around sort of the public notion of the Salvation Army at that time, even for men like Roosevelt Jr., who had some rather creative things to say about the Salvation Army up until this time where they started making donuts for the troops and really started providing for frontline troops. Like, we're talking in danger of mortars, in danger of gas. Like, they were there. They were really contributing. So what strikes me as curious about this propaganda poster is that it's not to our typical audience, our typical propaganda audience. It's not encouraging you to enlist or buy war bonds or, you know, to conserve your fats or to go on scrap drives or things like that. This is for the Salvation Army lassie, keep her on the job. Who's the audience for this? Well, the United War Work Campaign is who's delivering the message, and it's dated November 11th through 18th, 1918. Now, we all know the armistice takes place on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month of 1918, but they didn't make this up after the fact. Like, they didn't whip these posters up and come up with a campaign once the armistice was signed. This was a campaign designed far prior to the armistice being signed and in advance knowledge of the date that that armistice was being signed, presumably to keep these gals, these lassies who were so important to the U.S. morale, the doughboy troops, and so important to their mental well-being, that they were going to keep them somehow involved in war work. So a very, very interesting poster. Again, like, I'm not an aviation expert. I am not a Salvation Army historian expert either. This is a pretty niche bit of Great War history that I'm not familiar with, but this poster and its color and its message definitely make me want to investigate more. Now, next to my left is probably my favorite poster that's being offered in the auction, and it's just bold. It's simple, it's to the point, but it's buy a little present for the Kaiser. The boys in France will deliver them. Liberty Fourth Loan, Union Trust Company, Chicago, a bank of strength and character. And boy, they're showing some of that strength with 50% of this poster area being dedicated to armament. Giant artillery shells, 5-round clips for those 1903s that our boys were carrying over. Even some M1 grenades, which, attention detail matters, are properly sectioned into 4 sections for better fragmentation. Of course, we have our belt of ammo just kind of traipsing around it all. We are, of course, dealing with a World War I propaganda poster with references to the Kaiser. Now, the poster as a whole, I also love. This red is very, very bright. The color of the brass is still appropriate. Kind of matches the Union Trust logo down there. I mean, just what a cool thing, first of all, to have all this armament and for a business to be essentially producing or sponsoring this poster. Like, it just seems so foreign in today's day and age, but how cool for them to make it. So I love the color. I love that half of it is essentially weapons and the bottom half is a little tongue-in-cheek message for the Kaiser, a real kind of a tough guy comment for a bank to be making. And we have some of these great markings on here, the Central Printing and Engraving Company in Chicago, so they're printing locally, Society of Poster Art. I love seeing these torn edges. They're a little bit yellowed. Again, kind of lending towards authenticity, not guaranteeing it. Don't know how many more times I can say I'm not an expert in poster authenticity or authentication, but what a fantastic poster. And that black is still nice and crisp as well. I would love to have that in my office. Next on our list, oh boy, talk about a graphic poster. Less dangerous than careless talk. Don't discuss troop movements, ship sailings, or war equipment. And in the bottom, we have, you know, distributed for the issuing agencies of, and I can't read the rest from the frame, but the U.S. Government Printing Office, 1944, which totally makes sense. This screams World War II to me. The imagery is, oh man, it's fantastic. We have a rattlesnake, which, you know, dripping blood as if it's been, you know, just sank its teeth out of something. Or maybe been chewing on a steak. I love it, how bloody and graphic it is. Like, these were meant to show how dangerous it was. Kind of ironic that this is a big dangerous thing, but rattlesnakes, of course, a very early American symbol. So to see the rattlesnake used in a different way, where you were normally like, don't tread on me because I'm dangerous and I will bite you, versus now we're referring to like careless talk being the dangerous snake. So a shift in change from what that the rattlesnake would be in a message, but ultimately just what a great propaganda poster. These green eyes, the blue shaking lines, a little bit of yellowed paper, all the fold lines. It's everything you want to see a propaganda poster. I really like this one. To my right, boy, talk about graphic propaganda posters, is this one, Miles of Hell to Tokyo, work where you're needed. Consult your U.S. Employment Service office. Obviously, now we're in World War II era posters. Reference to Tokyo. We do have a pretty nice depiction of an M1 Garand and its sling there. And this is a soldier. Now, we look at the type, and it'll help us a little bit, too. Look down here. We have the U.S. Government Printing Office dated 1945. So we're definitely towards the tail end of the war effort. The U.S. has been at war for 4 years. And this, I think, reflects pretty well how everybody probably felt about it in 1945. There's bloodied, tired, crawling around. We've expended all our shells. We have fought the good fight. But guess what? There's still miles of hell to Tokyo. Don't quit now. Work where you're needed. Bright warning colors, this red and this yellow contrast. Like, in addition to being eye-catching, those are very alarm-type colors, just like they would be in a stoplight or you'd see in a road sign. Like, they're using these colors for a reason. He's dirty. He's bloodied. Even places where he's not physically dripping blood, he's bloodied. What a great poster to symbolize, you know, that effort, that fatigue, the war fatigue that the populace was probably feeling in 1945. But there's still, you know, miles to go before I sleep. Miles of hell before Tokyo. A really cool poster. Now on my left, here we are back in the Great War. If you can't tell from the uniform, we even have down here, you know, copyright 1918 by American Lithographic Company. Looking at the poster as a whole, I like it. It's lost some of its vibrant nature. This red is not like this bright, screaming red. It shows it's faded. It's aged a little bit. That's always encouraging. In fact, all this sort of brown speckling that we have from the bottom is not on what would be like a pristine or an original poster when they were printed. So again, a little bit of damage, a little bit of wear, always a good sign, at least in my mind. We have a date, but again, you know, dates can be reproduced. So if you are looking for authenticity, do be careful. But here we have, you know, the dapper mustached American troop, and he's, you know, everything he's holding and protecting. Help him win by saving and serving. War saving stamps issued by the U.S. government by war saving stamps. And you'll notice a little change in tone from our very violent posters with our warning colors. Here we have a lot of green and blue hues. Like, this is supposed to make us feel all warm and comfy, but our bright red message up here, help him win by saving and serving. War saving stamps issued by the U.S. government. Classic propaganda, even down to the, you know, the blonde ringlets of his little girl, his boy in his suit as he holds their hand and probably wishes them well before he heads off back to war. Great propaganda poster, classic messaging, classic colors. Nice condition as well. Well, that's a really fun piece to have in the sale. So next on the list is a photograph, or maybe printing of a photograph. Again, I didn't take it out of the frame to check. And it raised an interesting question, and I thought maybe some of my American military historian experts or specialists might be able to weigh in the comments below. Very cool photo, of course. Man firing an M14. We notice two rounds being discharged here. In and of itself, pretty cool photo, pretty cool stop photo to capture those bullets in flight. But what my first thought was, is those bullets, they look a little conical. They don't look of the typical shape that we would think of a regular, you know, bullet or slug or projectile. So I was wondering, did someone capture this just to capture the full auto fire of an M14? Or because these projectiles are more conical in shape, is this actually a photo of something maybe even the salvo project? There's only two bullets. One would expect, I guess, if it were a burst or he was continued fire, we would see a third projectile and more smoke. Maybe we just caught the end of a two projectile burst or a two shot burst, but it was just the conical shape of those projectiles. Now, which, like I get said, already cool, but if this is a photo of salvo project stuff where we're dealing with duplex and triplex bullets to really try to increase hit percentage, if you're not familiar with the project, search online. Fascinating stuff in weapons development. If that's a project of salvo rounds, cool factors through the roof, at least for me. So next is, I just love it. I absolutely love it. So we have this, this is dated on the bottom, copyright 1914 by the Messenger Publishing Company in Chicago. We have this scene of European forces fighting each other. We have our Mauser 98s here on the floor. We have this man, you know, bleeding from his chest. The flag is down. Pistols, dead bodies. There's artillery being leveled horizontally at people. We have burning cities in the background. This guy's got a sword out. Like, this is the nitty-gritty of war. We are in the trenches. And then, of course, there's the very historical recreation of Jesus Christ visiting the trenches. It's just, what a fabulous piece of propaganda at the time. I love it. And last but not least, is this really cool reproduction of a Winchester WW bullet board. Now, you've seen these in our premier auctions. You'll know that these are framed. They often have like the actual cartridges. These were used as advertising tools for Winchester back in the day to display at retailers who would sell the Winchester products or the Winchester ammunition. Oftentimes bullets are missing. Backgrounds are faded. I mean, these have been hanging in stores as display pieces, so sometimes they're not in the best condition, but when they are in good condition, whether it's the double W or the single W, you can find them easily fetching $30,000, $40,000 for an old Winchester advertisement. Pretty cool. This has none of the shells. This is a reprint of one with the bear hunting scene, with the moose and the mallard. Very cool. So if you don't want to drop $30,000 on an original Winchester WW bullet board, here's a cheap way to throw one in your office. And this is life size, mind you. Here's an inexpensive way to put one in your office or your gun room without having perhaps to go to that cost for an original with the original shells. Now, this is lot 2057, so it's going to sell probably within the first 30 or 45 minutes of day two of our June Sporting and Collector Firearms Auction. Again, you can see all these items online on our website. There is still time to place your bids at rockislandauction.com. Thanks for watching, everybody. Hope you enjoyed something a little different. Until next time, keep that powder dry.